directed by Noah McRae Jones. This is the second show. And it's one of those wonderful plays of the early modern period that shows us that Middleton had a really interesting view of gender. So, welcome. Thomas Middleton's The Roaring Girl.
Lines to the wayside have gone. The ever-present pulse of time beats on. But less restrictions cause both gripe and fist. In truth, you've left in all the juicy bits. Your faces display incredulity. How can 13 create full 23? For sake of clarity, we now give aid and here present a character parade. Sir Alexander Wengrave.
Younger.
tender sonnet. Is it in his ear? Sweet
damsel, emblem of fragility, you desire to have a message transported or to be transcended?
A private word or two, sir, nothing else.
You shall fructify in that which you came for. Your pleasure shall be satisfied to your full contentation. I will, fairest tree of generation, watch when our young master is erected, that is to say, up, and deliver him to this, your most white hand.
Thanks, sir.
And withal certify him that I have culled out for him, now his belly is replenished, a daintier bit or modicum than any lay upon his trencher at dinner. Have you notion of your name, I beseech your chastity?
One, sir, of whom he was made falling bands.
Falling bands. Presently it shall so be given him.
If you please to venture your modesty in the hall amongst a curl-pated company of rude serving men and take such as they can set before you, you shall be most seriously and ingeniously welcome.
I have dined indeed already.
Or have you got seat to kiss the lip of a cup of rich Orleans in the buttery amongst our waiting women?
Not now, in truth, sir.
Our young master shall then have a feeling of your being here. Presently it shall so be given.
I humbly thank you, sir. Oh, but that my bosom is full of bitter sorrows, I could smile to see this formal ape play antic tricks. But in my breast a poisoned arrow sticks, and smiles cannot become me. Love, woven slightly, such as thy false heart makes, wears out as lightly. But love, being truly bred in a soul like mine, bleeds even to death at the least wound it takes. The more we quench this fire, the less it slakes. Oh, me!
Sister, speak with me, sayest thou?
Yes, sir, she's there, Viva Voce, to deliver her auricular confession.
With me, sweetheart? What is it?
I have brought home your bands, sir.
Bands?
Meefoot.
Sir.
Prithee, look in, for all the gentlemen are upon rising.
Yes, sir, a most methodical attendant shall be given.
Dost thou hear? If my father call for me, say I am busy with a sempster.
Yes, sir. He shall know you're busy with a needlewoman.
In his ear, good Meefoot.
Presently shall be so given him.
Bands? You are mistaken, sweetheart. I mistake none. When? Where? I prithee, what bands? Let me see them.
Yes, sir. A bond fast sealed with solemn oaths, subscribed unto as I thought with your soul. Delivered as your deed in sight of heaven, is this bond cancelled? Have you forgotten me?
Life of my life, Sir Guy Fitzalbert's daughter.
What has transformed my love to this so strange shape? Stay, make all sure. For speak and be brief, for the wolf is at the door that lies in wait to prey upon us both. Albeit thine eyes are blessed by thine, yet this so strange disguise holds me with fear. And wonder.
Mine's a morbid sight. Why from it are you banished else so long?
Sweet maid, let's lose no time. 'Tis in heaven's book set down that I must have thee. An oath we took to keep our vow. But when the night your father was from mine parted, storms began to sit upon my covetous father's brow, and fell from them on me. He reckoned up what gold this marriage would draw for him, and swore to lose so much blood as could not grieve a father more. He then dissuades me from thee, called thee not fair, and asked what is she but a beggar's heir. He scorned thy dowry of 5,000 marks, if such a sum of money could be found, and vowed, if I took thee, nay more did swear it, save life from him I nothing should inherit.
What follows then? My shipwreck?
Dearest, no. For wildly in a labyrinth I go, my end is to meet thee. With a side wind must I now sail, else I no haven can find, but both must sink forever. There's a wench named Moll, Mad Moll, or Merry Moll, a creature so strange in quality, a whole town takes note of her name and person. All the affection I owe to thee, on her in counterfeit passion, I spend to Mad my father. He believes I dote upon this roaring girl, and grieves as becomes a father for a son that could be so bewitched. Yet I'll keep on in this crooked way, sigh still for her, feign dreams in which I'll talk only of her. These streams shall, I hope, force my father to consent that here I anchor, rather than be rent upon a rock so dangerous. Art thou pleased? Because thou seest we are waylaid, I take a path that's safe, though it be far about.
My prayers in heaven guide me.
Then I will on. My father is at hand. Kiss. And be gone. Hours shall be watched for meetings. I must now, as men for fear, to a strange idol bow.
Farewell.
Oh, God be on. When next we meet, a story of Maul shall make our mirth more sweet.
Thanks, good mother Alexander, for our bounteous cheer!
Fie, and giving thanks you pay too dear.
When bounty spreads the table, faith for sin is going out, if thanks should not step in.
No more of thanks, no more. Mary, the inner room was too close. How like you this parlor, gentlemen?
Oh, passing well! What a sweet breath the air casts here! So cool!
I like the prospect best!
See how 'tis furnished.
A very fair, sweet room!
Sir Davy Dapper, the furniture that doth adorn this room cost many a fair great road ere it came here, but good things are most cheap that are most dear. Nay, when you look into my galleries, how bravely they're trimmed up, I'm sure you'll swear you're highly pleased to see what's set down there. Stories of men and women mixed together, fair ones with foul, like sunshine in wet weather. Within one square, 1,000 heads are laid so close that all of heads the room seems made. And here and there, whilst with obsequious ears the throng in heaps do listen, a cutpurse thrusts and leers with hawk's eyes for his prey. I shall not show him. By a hanging, villainous look, yourselves shall know him. His face is drawn so rarely.
These sights are excellent.
This gentleman, my friend, will take his leave, sir.
Take his leave, Sebastian. Oh,
this gentleman.
Not so, sir. A merry day, month's friends being spent, is better than gold saved. Some wine, some wine.
At your worship level, sir.
Chairs, stools, cushions. Sir Davy Dapper, make this chair thine.
Tis but an easy gift, and yet I thank you for it, sir. I'll take it.
A chair for old Sir Adam Appleton.
A back friend to your worship.
Very good, Kneefoot. I thank thee for it. Back friends sometimes are good.
A friend. Make this stool thy perch, good Master Goshawk.
I stoop to your lure, sir.
Son Sebastian, take Master Greenwit. Do you?
Sit, dear friend.
Nay, Master Laxton. Furnish Master Laxton that which he wants.
A stone.
A stool, I would say a stool.
I understand, sir.
I know you had, good Master Laxton. Well, here is a mess of friends and gentlemen, and because time's glass will not be running long, I'll quicken it with a pretty tale.
Good tales do well in these bad days where vice does so excel.
Last day, I met an aged man upon whose head was scored a debt of just so many years as these which I owe to my grave, the man you all know. Quoth he, I have a son that like a wedge doth cleave the very heart root.
How finally, like a fencer, my father fetches his by-blows to hit me. But if I beat thee not by weapon of subtlety...
That son, saith he, who should be the column and center arch to my house and crutch to my old age, becomes a whirlwind to shake the firm foundation.
What then could vex his father so?
A woman.
Ooh, a flesh fly that'll vex any man.
A scurvy woman, upon whom the passionate old man swore he doted. A creature, saith he, that nature hath brought forth to mock the sex of woman. It is a thing one knows not how to name. Her birth began before she was all made. 'Tis woman more than man more than woman, and which to none can hap, the sun doth give her two shadows to one shape.
Tis false.
Boy!
Tis false.
What's false? I say she's naught.
I say that tongue that dares speak so. But your stick's in the mouth of a rank villain. Set yourself aside.
So, boy, what then?
Any here else had lied, I think I shall fit you.
Lie?
Yes.
Doth this concern him?
Sirrah, boy, is thy blood heated? Boils it? Art thou stung? I will pierce thee deeper yet.
Ah, my dear friends, I am that wretched father, and this the son that sees his ruin and yet headlong on the throne.
Will you love such a poison?
Fie, fie!
We're all mad.
Why, sir, 'tis thought Sir Guy Fitzallard's daughter shall wed your son, Sebastian.
Sir Davy Dapper, I have upon my knees wooed this fond boy to take that virtuous maiden.
One word, good sir. You, on your knees, have cursed that virtuous maid and me for loving her. Do you now thus baffle me to my face? Wear not your knees in such entreats. Give me Fitzallard's daughter.
I'll give thee ratsbane, Robert.
I'm deaf to you all. I'm so bound to my desires. Tears, prayers, threats. Nothing shall quench out those fires that burn within me.
Her blood will quench it then. Lose him not, but dissuade him, gentlemen.
No more, no more, away!
Away!
Wild buck, I will hunt thee breathless. Thou wilt run on, but I will turn thee when I'm not thought. Now, Sarah, what are you?
Lead your ape's tricks, speak.
A letter from my captain to your worship.
Oh, I remember. 'Tis to prefer thee to my service.
To be a shifter under your master's nose of a clean trencher when there's a good bit upon it.
Troth, honest fellow,
this day shall be the axe to hew down that at which I stumble.
As a face promises much of a villain, I'll grind his wit if the edge prove fine, make use of it. Come hither, Sarah. It's never, as thou walked about this town, hear tell of a wench named Moll. Mad Mary Moll.
Moll Cutpurser?
If you will, I'll find her out.
Here's money. Spend it. That being spent, fetch more. Deep spending may draw her who is most chaste to a man's bosom. Or rather, for 'tis better. They say sometimes she goes about in breeches. Follow her as her man.
And when her breeches are off,
she shall follow me.
Bend all thy brains to serve her.
Zoon, sir, as country wenches be cream till buttercup.
Play thou the subtle stone. We find nets to ensnare her very life.
Her life?
Be firm, and gain me ever thine own. That done, I entertain thee. How is thy name?
My name is Ralph Trapdoor, honest Ralph.
Trapdoor, be like thy name. A dangerous step for her to venture on, but unto me.
As fast as your soul to your boot or shoe, sir,
hence. Be seen here as little as thou canst. I'll still be at thy elbow.
The trapdoor is set. Maul, if you budge, you're gone. This me shall crown a ruined boy the ruined girl puts down.
God almighty, waste no time.
Gentlemen, what is you buy? What is you lack? See, fine bands and rocks, fine lawns, fine cambrics. What is you lack, gentlemen? What is you buy?
Yonder's the shop.
Is that she?
Yes.
She that mends tobacco.
Why, she's a gentlewoman born, that can I tell you, though it be her hard fortune now to shred Indian pot herbs.
No, sir, 'tis many a good woman's fortune when her husband turns bankrupt to begin with pipes and set up again.
And indeed, the raising of the woman is the lifting of the man's head at all times, and if one flourish, t'other will bud as soon, I warrant.
Go! Thou art a mystical lecher! Away! Go!
'Tis the closest striker. Life, I think he commits better in foot deep.
No man's aware on it. I, like a palpable smockster, go to work so openly in the tricks of art that I'm apparently as seen as a naked boy in a file. And were it not for a gift of treachery I had in me to betray my friend when he puts most trust in me?
Mass,
yonder he is too. And by his injury to make good my access to her, I shall appear as defective in courting as a farmer's son the first day of his feather, who does not
nothing at court but woo the glass windows and hangings for a month together, and some broken waiting woman forever after. He shall not see me yet.
Troth, this is finely shred.
Ah, women are the best mincers.
'Tad been a good phrase for a cook's wife, sir.
But 'twill serve generally, like the cover of a new almanac, as thus, calculated for the merit not of cook's wives, but generally for all English women.
Nay, you shall have, sir. I have filled it for you.
I must speak a word with you anon.
What's the matter now, sir?
I protest by an extreme want of money. If you can supply me now with any means, you do me the greatest pleasure. Next to the bounty of your love, as ever poor gentleman tasted.
What's the sum would pleasure ye, sir, though you deserve nothing less at my hands?
'Tis but for want of opportunity, thou knowest. I put her off with opportunity still. By this light, I hate her but for the means to keep me in fashion with gallants. For the money I have from her, I spend on other wenches. But bear her in hand still. She has wit enough to rob her husband, and I ways enough to consume the money.
Jack Dapper!
This is your dapper! Oh, I died down to your ankles!
Save ye, gentlemen! All three in a peculiar salute.
How are you going, Jack?
Faith, to buy one feather.
One feather? The fool's peculiar still.
Oh, God.
Master.
Here's three happens for your ordinary boy. Meet me an hour hence in Paul's.
How? Three single halfpence? Why, this will scarce serve a man in sauce. A half-worth of mustard, a half-worth of oil, and a half-worth of vinegar. What's left, then, for the pickled herring? This shows like small beer in the morning after a great surfeit of wine or night. He could spend his £3 last night in a great supper amongst girls and brave body-house boys. This is the eggs of £3. I'll go sup them up presently.
8, 9, 10 angels. Good wench of faith and one that loves darkness well. I know she cousins her husband to keep me, and I will keep her honest as long as I may to do that poor gentleman some part of mend. The honest mind of a whoremaster.
Huff! I like it not.
What feathers do you have, sir? These are the most worn and most in fashion. I can inform you, 'tis the general feather.
And therefore I mislike it. Tell me of general. Show me a spangled feather.
Oh, to go a feasting with.
Life, yonder's Moll.
Well, which was
honest Moll.
Oh, pretty. Let's call her.
Moll!
Not now. What's the matter?
I would give but too much money to be nibbling with that wench. I'll lay hard siege to her, for money is the aquafortis that eats through many a maiden head. Where walls are flesh and blood, I'll ever pierce through with a golden auger.
I cannot stay, your faith. I'm going to buy a shag rope, then shop will be shut in presently. Let me see a good shag rope. Ah,
Mistress Small, that shalt thou in faith, the best in the shop.
Aha, now! Greetings, love terms, and a pox between you. Go, get you from my shop.
I come to buy.
I'll sell you nothing.
I warn thee, my house and shop.
You, goody openwork? You who prick out a poor living and sews many a body skin coat together? Thou private panders between shirt and smock. I wish that for a minute but a man. Thou shouldst never use such shapes. But as thou art to pity my revenge, I'm a spleen's up. I would not mock it, little one.
Sweet lump mall. When shall thou and I go a town together?
What to do there?
Nothing but we marry and lie together. I'll hire a coach with four horses.
What would be a beastly journey? You may leave out one well. Three horses will serve if I'm to play the jade myself.
Nay, posh, thou art such another kicking wench. Pretty be kind and let's meet.
'Tis hard, but we shall meet, sir.
They would appoint the place then. There's 10 angels in fair gold. You see, I do not trifle with you. Do but say we shall meet, and I'll have a coach waiting for me.
Well, here's my hand. We shall meet, sir.
Oh, good gold. The place. Sweet, Moll.
Raise the fields, then.
A match.
I'll meet you there.
The hour?
3.
Time enough to sell the Frankfurt.
I am of such a nature, sir, that I cannot buy the house when she scolds. She has a tongue. Can be heard farther on a still morning than St. Atlin's bell.
She rails at me for foreign wenching, that I, being a freeman, must needs keep a whore in the suburbs and seek to impoverish the liberties. When we fall out, I'll trouble you still to make things whole with my wife.
Tis no trouble, sir. Tis a pleasure for me to join things together.
Go thy way, goshawk. I do this but to test thy honesty.
How likest thou this, Moll?
Oh, singularly, you're fitted now for a bunch. He looks for all the world with those spangled feathers like a nobleman's bedpost.
Oh, abominable! Nay, more, I tell you in private. He keeps a whore in the suburbs!
Oh, spittle dealing! I came to him a gentlewoman born. I'll show you mine arms when you please, sir.
I'd rather see your legs and begin that way.
Tis well known. He took me of a lady's service, where I was well beloved of the steward. I had my Latin tongue and the spice of the French before I came to him, and now he keeps a suburban whore under my nostrils.
Nay, there's ways enough to cry quit with him. Hark, in thy ear.
There's a friend worth a million.
Matt, here she is.
I am bound to serve her already, though it be but a sluttish trick. Bless my hopeful young mistress with long life and great lens.
How now? Where thou?
A poor ebbing gentleman who would gladly wait for the young flood of your service.
My service? What should move you, sir, to offer your service to me?
Your heroic spirit and masculine womanhood.
What case we should retain you to us? What parts are there in you for a gentlewoman's service?
Of two kinds, movable and immovable. Movable to run of errands, and immovable to stand when you have occasion to use me.
What strength in you?
Strength, Mistress Maul, while I have been up to the steeple and stayed the great bell as it had been ringing, stopped the windmill going.
And never struck down yourself?
Stood as upright as I do at this present.
What, not stand?
Oh, I am of that nature that I love. I'd be at my mistress's foot to do her service.
Well, meet me in Gray's Inn Fields between 3 and 4 this afternoon, and upon better consideration, we'll retain you.
I thank your mistress. I'll crack your neck for this kindness.
3. Nay, if I fail you, hang me.
Wait, you fake! Hark! The bell rings. Come, gentlemen! Jack Dapper, where shall it all munch?
I am for Parker's ordinary.
We shall be your followers. Lead the way, Jack. By my life, the fool has feathered his nest well.
If a man have a free will, where should the use more perfect shine than in his will to love? All creatures have their liberty in that. Must my desires wear feathers? Yea, are you so near? I must break with my heart's truth, find grief at a back way. Well? Why, suppose the two-leaved tongues of slander or of truth pronounce Maul loathsome? If before my love she appear fair, what injury have I? I have the thing I like. In all things else, mine own eye guides me, and I find them prosper.
His brave willfulness, a made match. Here she comes. They met a purpose.
Oh, pardon me, sir. I thought not you so near.
I would be nearer to thee, and in that fashion that makes the best part of all creatures honest. No otherwise I wish it.
I am so poor to requite you, sir. You must look for nothing but thanks of me. I have no humor to marry. I love to lie on both sides of the bed myself. And on the other side, a wife you know ought to be obedient. Hear me, I am too headstrong to obey, therefore I'll ne'er go about it. I love you so well, sir, but for your goodwill, I should be loath you would repent your bargain after. I have the head now of myself, man enough for a woman. Marriage is but a chopping and a changing where a maiden loses one head and has a worse in the place.
This were enough now to affright a fool from thee forever, when 'tis the music I love thee for.
This a voice spoils all again.
Believe it, sir. I am not of that disdainful temper, but I could love you faithfully.
Pox on you for that word. Art a cunning word. you see that already.
Sleep upon this once more, sir. You may just shift your mind tomorrow. Be not too hasty to wrong yourself. Never while you live, sir, take a wife as if you were going to Virginia.
So we parted, my too cursed fate.
Who hath bewitched thee, son? What devil or drug has wrought upon the weakness of your blood and consigned all her fate to ruinous folly?
Why is the name of Moll so fatal, sir? I vowed to love her. Let all the storms oppose me that ever beat against the breast of man. Nothing but death's black tempest shall divide us.
This way I toil in vain and give but aim to infamy and ruin. He will fall. Why so vain? Let all these tears be lost. I'll pursue her to shame, and so all's crossed.
Plain dealing in this world takes no effect. I'll acquaint this mad girl with my intent. Get her assistance, make my fortunes known to her. Twixt lovers' hearts, she's a fit instrument, and has that art to help them to their own by her advice. For in that craft she's wise. My love and I may meet, spite of all spies.
Tis now about the hour of her appointment. And yet I see her not. What's this? One, two, three. Three by the clock at Savoy. This is the hour, and Grayson Field's the place she swore she'd meet me. I see none yet dressed like her. I must look for a shag ruff, a free jerkin, and a safeguard, or I get none. Moll, prithee, make haste.
Here's my gentleman, how his eye hawks for very. Come, are you ready, sir?
Ready, sir, for what?
You ask me that now, why was this being pointed?
Who's this Moll? Honest Moll!
So young and purblind, you're all wanton in your eyes, I can see that.
Thou art admirably suited for the three pigeons at Brainford. I swear I knew thee not.
I'll swear you did not, but you shall know me now.
Not here. We shall be spied. The coach is better come. What, Moll? Will you untruss a point?
Here's the point that I untruss. It has but one tag. T'will serve.
How?
Here's the gold which you hired your hackney. 10 angels of mine own I put to thine widow.
Moll. Mistress Mary,
draw, or I'll serve an execution on thee, shall lay thee up till doomsday.
Draw! Upon a woman! What dost thou mean, Moll?
To teach thy base thoughts manners. Thou art one of those that thinks each woman thy fond, flexible whore, she but cast a liberal eye upon thee. How many of our sex, by such as thou, have their good thoughts paid with a blasted name that never to serve loosely, or to trip in path of whoredom beyond cup and lip? But for stain of conscience and of soul, better had women fall into the hands of an act silent than a bragging nothing. There's no mercy in it. What nurse move you, sir, to think me whorish? Because you'll say I'm given to sport, I'm often merry, jest, and mirth no kindred in the world but lust. I scorn to prostitute myself to a man. I, who can prostitute a man to me. And so, I greet thee. Hear me. Would the spirits of all my slanders were clasped in thine, that I might vex an army at one time. Oh, I do repent me. Hold, you'll die of a Christian then.
Don't you confess that I have wronged thee, Moll?
Confession is but poor amends for wrong, unless a rogue would follow.
I ask thee pardon.
Bring your hired horse, sir.
I yield. A person by.
Both
by one thus, I might make pretty shift with them in time. My spirit shall be mistress of this house as long as I have time in. Oh, here's my man that would be. 'Tis his hour. Faith, he seems a well-set fellow, if his spirit be answerable to his uncle's. He seems a man without. I'll try what he is within.
She told me Gray's Inn Field, twixt 3 and 4. I'll fit her mistresship with a good piece of service. I'm hired to rid the town of one mad girl. Ah, what a pox ails you, sir!
Speak again, such a gentleman.
Hark! Is the field so narrow, or your eyesight? Lighty, come back.
What's that to me, sir?
I do not tell, sir.
Go, you're a coxcomb.
Coxcomb?
You're a slave.
I hope there's a law for you, sir.
Ye, do you see, sir?
This is no good dealing. Pray, tell me what house you're up.
One of the temples, sir.
Oh, mass, methinks. Oh, I'll not meddle with you for that trick, sir. You'll give me leave to go about my business.
Your business? I'll make you wait on me before I have done, and glad to serve me, too.
Ha! Serve you! Not if there were no more men in England.
But if there were no more women in England, I hope you'd wait upon your mistress, then.
Mistress!
You're a tried spirit and push, sir.
What would your worship have me do?
You a fighter?
Oh, no, I praise heaven. I had better grace and more manners.
Well, we shall try you further. In the meantime, we give you entertainment.
I thank your mistresship.
Come, follow me to St. Thomas Apostles. I'll put a livery coat upon your back first thing.
Aye, follow, dear mistress.
What? Prue? Nay, sweet Prudence!
Pray, be not so fond of me. Leave your city humors. I'm vexing you to see how like a cat you come bleating after me.
Nay, honey, Prue! I'm sure rising up before all the tables show, and flinging from my friends so uncivilly. Fie, Prue, fie. Come. What, mouse? Thy mind is nibbling at something. What is? What lies so heavy on thy stomach?
Must you be prying into a woman's secrets, say ye?
It is my love, dear wife.
Your love? Your love is all words. Give me deeds. I cannot abide men who's too fond of me. So cookish. Thou dost not know how to handle a woman in her kind.
Shall I leave thee, my Prue?
Fie. Fie. Fie!
Thou shalt not be vexed no more, pretty kind Rome. No cold, sweet Prue.
It is done. Now, Master Blackston, show your head. What news from you? Oh, sweet creature, a sweet beginning. Pardon my long absence, for thou shalt shortly be possessed with my presence. Though Aeneas made an ass of Dido, I will die to thee ere I do so. Oh, sweetest creature, make much of me, for no man beneath the silver moon shall make more of a woman than I do of thee. Furnish me, therefore, with 30 pounds. You must do this of necessity for me, for I languish till I see some comfort come from thee, protesting not to die in thy debt, but rather to live so, as I hitherto have and will, thy true Laxton ever. Alas, poor gentleman, and troth, I pity him. How shall I raise this money? Which way shall I turn? Laxton, what with my own fears and thy wants, I'm as a needle twixt two adamants.
Nay, nay, wife, the women are all up. Ha! How? Reading's a letter. I smell a goose, a couple of capons, and a gammon of bacon from her mother out in the country. I hold my life, steal, steal.
Oh, be sure your heart!
I'll see that letter, let me see it.
Oh, wouldst thou have no eyes to see the downfall of me and myself? I'm forever, forever I'm undone.
What the hell is my proof? What papers that thou tearest?
Oh, would I could tear my very heart in pieces, for my soul lies on the rack of shame that tortures me beyond a woman's suffering.
What means this?
Oh, my dear husband, where once I thought myself a fixed star, placed only in the heaven of thine arms, I fear now I shall prove a wanderer. Oh, Laxton, Laxton, is it then my fate to be by thee o'erthrown?
Defend me, wisdom, from falling into frenzy. On my knee. Sweet Prue, speak. What is that, Laxton, that lies so heavy on my bosom?
I shall sure run mad.
I shall run mad for company, then. Speak to me, I am Galifot, thy husband. What, Prue? Art sick in conscience for some villainous deed thou wert about to act? Didst mean to rob me? Tush! I'll forgive thee. Hast thou on my bed thrust my soft pillows neath another's head? I'll wink at all faults. Prue, lass, that's no more than some neighbors near thee have done before. Sweet honey, Prue, what's that, Laxton? I never heard such thunder.
Yes, yes, before I was to thee contracted, to him I swore. Since last I saw him, 12 months, 3 times told, the moon had thrown through her light silver bow. For o'er the seas he went, and it was said, but rumor lies, that he in France was dead. But he's alive! Oh, he's alive! He writ that letter which in rage I writ, swearing with oaths most damnably to have me, or tear me from this bosom. Oh, heaven save me!
How I be of him? Stop his mouth with gold! Thinks that will do?
Oh me, heavens grant it would! Yet now my senses are set more in tune. He writ, as I remember in his letter, that he in riding up and down had spent, ere he could find me, £30. So what?
He shall have £30! Let that stop all. Love's sweets taste best when we have drunk down gall. So our friends, come, smooth thy cheek. After a storm, the face of heaven looks sleek.
Did I not tell you these turtles were together?
How dost thou, Sirrah?
Why, sister Galifot!
Lord, how she's changed!
Is your wife ill, sir?
Indeed, la, sir, very ill, never worse.
How her head burns! Feel how her pulses work!
Sister, lie down a little, that always does me good.
In good sadness, I find best ease in that too. Had she laid some hot thing to her stomach?
No, but I will lay something at all.
Come, come, fools, you trouble her. Shall go, Mr. Galifot?
Yes,
sweet Master Tiltyard.
Sirrah Rosamond, I hold my life Galifot had vexed his name.
She has a horrible high color, indeed.
We shall have your face painted with the same red soon at night when your husband comes home from his robbers in a false alley. Thou wilt not believe me.
It cannot sink into me that he feeds on stale mutton abroad, having better and fresher at home.
What do
I say thee, where thou shalt see him stand at rack and manger?
I'd saddle him in his kind and spur him till he kick again.
Shall thou and I ride our journey then?
Here's my hand.
No more. Come, Master Tiltyard, shall we leap into the stirrups with our women and animal home?
Yes, yes. Come what?
In troth, sister, I hope you will do well for all this.
I hope I shall.
Farewell, good sister. Sweet Master Galifot.
Welcome, brother. Most kindly welcome, sir.
Thanks, sir, for our good cheer.
Sweet honey Prue, what's £30? Sweet duck, look cheerly.
Thou art worthy of my heart, thou buyest it dearly.
Oh! Let's light the tides against me! A puff of your apothecary ship!
Oh, for some blister to set him going. 'Tis one of Hercules' labors to tread one of these city hens, because their cocks are still crowing over them. There's no turning tail here, I must go.
Oh!
Oh! Husband, look, see, look!
Let me deal with him!
Bless you, sir!
And be you blessed too, sir, if you come in peace.
Have you any good pudding tobacco, sir?
Oh, pick him, a poor house, gentle sir! For my husband is not a man of weapon as you are. He knows all! I have opened up all before him in serving you.
Thanks! I should show my letters.
What need you, sir, to beat the drum of my wife's infamy and call all your friends together? She has confessed it already.
Sir, has she confessed it, then?
She has. Faith to me, sir, upon your letter sending.
I have.
If I let this iron cool, call me slave.
Do you hear, Dame Rudence? Think'st thou, vile woman, I shall take these blows and whack?
One word! Good sir.
So.
I have married her, and lean with her, and got 2 children on her body. Then put on that. Have you so beggarly an appetite when I upon a dainty dish am have fed to feed upon my scraps? By leaving? Sir?
Do I come near you now, sir?
But lady, you touch me!
Would you not scorn to wear my clothes?
Right, sir.
Then wear not her. She's a garment so fitting for my body, I'm loathed another should wear it. You'll undo both. Her! Your letter, as she said, complained you had spent in quest of her some 30 pounds. I'll pay it. Will this stop up the gap twixt you two?
Well, if I swallow this wrong letters, thank you. The money being paid, sir, I am gone. Oh, woman! Happy he's trust none!
How dost thou like my wit?
Rarely. That while that the servant of the first woman beguile has ever since all women's bosoms filled. Yar, apple eaters all, deceivers still.
Speak softly. What egg is there hatching now?
Mad Moll,
huh?
Must be let in without knocking at the back gate.
So
your chamber will be made bawdy.
Good. The time of their tilting?
Three.
The day.
This.
Away. Quiet. Watchers. The heart. I told them thou didst owe me money. Hold it up. Maintain it.
As stiffly as a Puritan does contention. Thus! I owe thee not the value of a half a penny halter!
Thou be hanged in an ear thou state so!
Has the knave vexed you, sir?
I asked him my money. He swears my son received it. That boy will ne'er cease heaping sorrow on my heart till he's broke it quite.
My son Jack Dapper then shall run with him, all in one pasture.
Prove your son bad too, sir.
As villainy can make him. Your Sebastian goes but on one drab, mine on a thousand. But I have in my brain a windmill going that shall grind to dust the follies of my son and make him wise, or a stark fool. Here's the springe I have set to catch this woodcock in. An action under a false name, unknown to him, is entered in the counter to arrest Jack Dapper. I have sent for a couple of bears, shall paw him.
Oh, who comes yonder?
These look like cutouts. These should be there.
I know them. They are officers. We'll leave you, sir.
My good knights, leave me. You see, I'm haunted now with spirits.
Very well, sir.
This old muscle chop should be he by the fellow's description. Save you, sir! Come hither, you mad varlets! Did not my man tell you I watched here for you?
One in a blue coat told us that in this place an old gentleman would watch for us, a thing contrary to our oaths, for we are to watch for every wicked member of a city.
You'll watch them for 10,000. What's thy name, honesty?
Sergeant Curtilax, aye, sir.
An excellent name for a sergeant, Curtilax. Sergeants indeed should be weapons of the law. What young toward whelp's this?
Of the same litter, his yeoman, sir. My name is Hanger.
Yeoman Hanger. One pair of shears should cut out both your coats. You have two names most dangerous to men's throats.
We are as other men are, sir. But I cannot help but think that he who makes a great show of honesty and religion, if his claws fasten to his liking, he draws blood. For all men in the world are but great fish and little fish and feed upon one another.
Spoke like a noble Cerberus. Is the action entered?
His name is entered in the book of unbelievers!
Be as dog to him as your office allows you to be. Look to your prey, my true English wolves, and so I vanish.
So, warden of the sergeant, beget this old fellow upon my life. Stand close.
Shall the ambuscado lie in one place?
No. Look thou yonder.
Oh, mistress.
Do you smell carrion?
Carrion? No, yet I smell ravens.
Whist!
Leave me, it shall go hard, huntsman, but I'll spoil your game.
Of course, Captain, the bear comes to the stake!
Or it should be so, for the dog struggled to be let loose.
Hark, trapdoor, falling within.
Go, master! Did ever see such an ass as I am? of your own.
Honest sergeant!
Run, Master Badger, run! Or you'll be arrested else!
Oh, run, villain, run!
Run, Master! God follows you!
Maul shall bail him by these hands.
Now, trapdoor, will she come?
In man's apparel. I am in her heart now and share in all her secret.
Peace, peace. Take my German watch. Hang it up in sight that I may see her hang in English for it.
I warrant you for that, sir. Next session, reach her! This watch will bring in her more than 100 constables!
Trapdoor, sayest thou so? Thou cheerest my heart after a storm of sorrow. Place it on the court cupboard. Let it lie full view of her thief whorish eye. Here, take my rough band with the diamond in it. Perhaps she'll like that best. Oh, that my mysteries of such straits must run that I must rob myself to bless my son.
Thou hast done me a kind office without touch either of sin or shame. Thy loves are honest.
I'd scorn to make such shift to bring you together else.
Now have I time and opportunity, without all fear, to bid thee welcome, love.
Never with more desire or harder venture.
How strange this shows, one man to kiss another.
I'd kiss such men to choose, Moll. Methinks a woman's lip tastes well with a doublet. Here we are saved, and furthest from the eye of suspicion. This is my father's chamber, upon which floor he never steps till night.
And what is your business now you have your mind, sir? At your great suit I promised you to come. I pitied her for namesake, that a Moll should be so crossed in love when there's so many that owes 9 lays apiece and not so little. My tailor fitted her, I like you his work.
So well, no art can mend it for this purpose. But to thy wit and help we are chief in debt.
Any honest pity I'm willing to bestow upon poor Ringdoves.
I'll give no worse play.
Nay, and you should, sir. I should draw first and prove the quicker man.
Hold! There needs no weapon at this meeting. End thy quarrel singing.
I've heard her much commended, sir, for one that was ne'er taught.
I am much beholding to him. I dream there is a mistress, and she lays out the money. She goes unto her sisters, she never comes at any. She says she went to the verse for patterns. You shall find her at St. Catherine's, and come home with ne'er a penny.
Mary, amen say I.
So say I too.
All this while I was in a dream. A watch, what's the clock here?
Now she's trapped.
Nay, between 1 and 2, I care not. And a dangling diamond. Here's a brave booty for an evening thief now.
This is the roaring wench must do us good.
No poison, sir, but serves us for some use, which is confirmed.
Peace! Peace, foot! I did hear him sure, wherever he be.
Who did you hear?
My father. 'Twas like a sight of his. I must be wary. Life, here he comes. Sir, I beseech you, take it. Your way of teaching doth so much content me that I'll make it 4 pounds. Here's 40 shillings, sir. I think I name it right. Help me, good Moll. 40 and a half?
How now?
Sir!
What is he there?
A gentleman, a musician, one of excellent fingering.
I think so. I wonder how they escaped her. I have bethought myself. And since my art fails, I will make her policy the art to trap her. Here are 4 angels marked with holes in them, the cracked companion. Gold he will give her. These will I make induction to her ruin, enriching from my house and grief from my heart.
Here, son, that in content and pleasure, want shall not curb you. Pay the gentleman his latter.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, may this operation end it in 3. Her life, shame in him, grief in me.
Thou shalt have him. 'Tis my father's gift. Never was man with a shift.
He that can take me for a male musician, I cannot choose and play upon him.
One, two, three, four.
Stay away from the ball and Jamie. We're all here undivided, but forever we'll be free. So stay away aboard. I wore seven drunken pirates for the seven deadly sins. But I didn't look for someone reeling. Johnny's drunk his stomach on the blessed became a rebel. The same for you and me. Grappling with their demons in me. Sufferers, you suffer all.
Goat? Baboon? Did I do it?
Barely.
daggers through my heart.
Why stay you here? The star by which you sail shines yonder over Chelsea. You lose your shore. If this moonlight you seek out your life whore.
What?
Push your western puff.
Susan's how hell roars.
With whom you tilted at a pair of oars this very morning.
Oars?
At Brayford, sir.
Rack not my patience. Master Gossard, some slave has buzzed this into her. Has he not? I don't want to tilt in Brayford with a woman. 'Tis a lie. What old boy has told thee this? I'm sold. 'Tis a lie.
'Tis one that to thy face will justify all I speak.
God's death. Do but name the villain.
I will not
stay thee there for all this.
Sister, know you this varlet?
Yes.
His name?
Not for the world. Have you to stab him?
Oh, brave girls with gold.
Master Gossard, pray, sir, swear to me thou knowest him or knowest him not, who makes me in Brayford to take up a petticoat besides my wife.
By heaven, a man I know not!
Come, come, you lie!
Do you not have a lout? By heaven, I know no man beneath the moon to know you wrong, but if I had his name, I'd print it in text letters!
Print thine own, then!
Mine own shame be confirmed.
No more. He's stung.
Pardon me.
Truth, I do. This blemish lies in nature, not in you. For man's creation fixed even molds in scorn on fairest cheeks. Wife, nothing is perfect born.
I thought you had been born perfect.
Is the world but a guilt-rotten pill? But the heart is the old chore still. I tell you, Master Gossard, in your eye I have seen wanton fire. And so to try the soundness of my judgment, I told you I kept a whore. Made you believe 'twas true. Only to find the world can hardly yield a perfect friend. Come, come! A trick of youth, and 'tis forgiven! This rub put by, our love can run more even!
We'll deal upon men's wives no more!
No! You teach me a trick for that!
Troth, do not.
Make my house thine still, sir!
No!
I say thou shalt. See, thus beseech you still holds out, can never fall.
With me, sir?
You, sir, have been stumbling up and down by your door this hour to watch for you!
What's the matter?
I've caught a cold in my head, sir, but I hope you understand my speech.
So, sir?
I serve you by the name of Hippocrates Gallipot, and you by the name of Prudence Gallipot, to appear upon Crestino. Do you see? Crestino, Sancti, Dusti. This Easter term at Bow Church.
Where, sir? What says he?
Bow Church. To enter to a libel of pre-contract under the part and behalf of the said Prudence and another. Your best, sir, take copy of this citation.
Tis but 12 pence.
A citation?
You pocky-nosed rascal! What slave fees you to this?
Slave?
I had nothing to do with you. Do you hear, sir?
Laxton, is it not?
What beggary is this?
Trust me. I thought, sir, long ago these storms had been full laid. For if you be remembered, I paid you the last £15, besides the 30 you had before. But then you swore.
Tush, tush, sir, oaths. Truth, though I am loath to vex you, tell you what. Make up the money I had £100, and take your belly full of her.
£100?
£100? Take, sir, the 80. Do you seek my undoing?
I'll bait not 1/6.
Your slave, thou cheat! I'll now tear money from my throat! Husband, lay hold on that tiny coat!
Up the man, young gentleman! Seeing that your woman is so hot. I must lose my hair in her company, I see.
His hair sheds off, and yet he speaks not so much of the nose as he did before.
He has had a better courtier.
Master Greenwich, is your wit so raw that you would play no better a part than a sumner's?
I pray. Plays a knack to know an honest man in this company?
Husband, pardon me, I did dissemble. Told thee I was his pre-contracted wife when letters came from him for £30. I had no shift but that. He, having wasted them, now comes for more, using me as a ruffian doth his whore who
served in a cuckold's coat cut out upon. That will talk hereafter. You're a villain!
Hear me but speak, sir. You shall find me none.
Pray, sir, be patient and hear him.
I am muzzled for biting, sir. Use me how you will.
The first hour that your wife was in mine eye, myself with other gentlemen sitting by in your shop tasting smoke and speech being used, that men who have fairest wives are most abused and hardly scape the horn. Your wife maintained that only such spots in city dames were stained. She vowed no man by wit or wile never so fine spun should yourself beguile of what in her was yours.
Yet, true, 'tis well. Play out your game at Irish, sir. Who wins?
I scorn that one woman thus should vex all men. And what more vexed me, a she-citizen? Therefore I laid siege to her. Out she held, gave many a brave repulse, and me compelled with shame to sound retreat to my hot lust. Then, seeing all base desire rake up in dust, and that to her modest ears I swore never to presume again, she said her eye would ever give me welcome honestly, and since I was a gentlewoman, it ran... Gentlemen, she would my state relieve. But, sir, I swear, by heaven and by books men lay up there, I neither have nor had a base intent to wrong your bed. What's done is merriment. Your gold I pay back with this interest. When I had power most to do it, I wronged you least.
Then, sir, I am beholden not to you, wife, but to Master Laxton, that is wont of doing ill, which it seems you have not. Tarrying down here, all! Oh!
Brother, we have a jest as good as yours to furnish out the feast.
We'll crowd our table with it. Wife, brag no more of holding out. Who most brags is most poor.
Oh, on so, Maul. Where's that trap door?
Hang that thing by this point. A justice of this town that speaks of nothing but away with him to Newgate. Use that rogue like a firework to run upon a line betwixt him and me. And away slid I my man like a shuffleboard shilling. He spreads up and down the suburbs now, I think, and eats up four speeds upon a ball I started.
Sirrah, Captain Mad Mary, the god, my own father, dapper Sir Davy, laid these London boot-hailers, the catchpoles, in ambush to set upon me.
Your father away, Jack.
Oh, by the tassels of this handkerchief, 'tis true. Though a counter, which is a park in which all the wild beasts of the city run head by head, contain me.
Shall we set upon this infantry, these troops afoot? Zoot! Yonder's Maul, my whore's mistress and master. Would I add her kidneys between my teeth?
I'd rather have a cow wheel!
Zoot! I am so patched up she cannot discover me. Will all?
Alcarado, then!
Good, your honors and worship, enlarge your ears to let the sound of a hoarse military bagpipe penetrate your pitiful bowels to extract some of those so many small drops of silver as may give a hard straw bed lodging to a couple of maimed soldiers.
Where are you maimed?
In both our leather limbs.
come down, now, let's give him something. Last poor man, what money have you? By my truth, I love a soldier with my soul.
Where have you served?
In any part of the Low Countries.
We're not in the Low Countries, if it please you, but in Hungary, against the Turk at the siege of Belgrade.
Thou looks like a strange creature, a fat butterbox, yet speaks English. What art thou?
Ich mein Herr, ich bin den ruffling tearcat, den brave soldado. Ich bin durch all Deutschland gewesen, der Schellung das Mira in a base double. In a word game, ich slag und stroh vom Tonkopf, dass ich den 100,000 Dieren am Frohlich, mein Herr.
I take measure of you better than a tailor can, and I'll fit you as you, monster with one eye, have fitted me.
Your worship will not abuse a soldier.
soldier. Thou deserves to be hanged up by that tongue which so dishonors a noble profession. Soldier, thou skeleton of varlet. Hold. Stand. There should be a trap door here.
Oh, the balls of these glaziers of mine. My eyes shall be shot up in any hot piece of service for my invincible mistress.
What's thy name, fellow soldier?
I am known by those that have seen my valor, Tearcat.
Tearcat?
A mere whipjack, and that is, in the Commonwealth of Rome, a slave that can talk of sea fight, yet indeed all of his service is by land, and that is to rob some fair or venturous exploit. Tearcat foot, see, I have your name now. I remember me in my book of horners, horse for the thumb, you don't have.
No, indeed, Captain Maul, for I know you by sight. I am no such nipping Christian, but a maunderer on the pad, I confess. And meeting with honest trapdoor here, whom you had cashiered from bearing arms, out at elbows, under your colors, I instructed him in the rudiments of roguery. And by my map made him sail over any country you can name, so that now he can maunder better than myself.
So then, trapdoor, thou art turned soldier now?
Alas, there were no wars!
'Twas the safest course of life I could take.
Then I hope you, sir, can cant, for by your cudgels, you, sirrah, are an upright man.
As well as any man walks the highway, I assure you.
Sirrah, where's your doxy? Halt not with me.
Doxy? Maul, what's that?
His wench.
My doxy waits for me at the boozing tin, brave captain.
He says his wench stays for him in an alehouse. You are no pure rogue.
Call you this canting?
Come, you rogue, cant with me. A gauge of an rum booze and a boozy kin of rum will.
Is better than a castor, peck pan, lay a poplar, which we mill in Dukesville.
Oh, I would live all the lightmans. Oh, I would live all the darkmans.
By the sword and under the rock and by the sword and in the heart.
Captain Weir, friend ring, capture the valley, dark my dells on my boozy nab, my skew rum booze well, boozy nab, my skew rum booze well.
Alas to the path, let us be. Alas to the path, let us be.
The grating of 10 new cartwheels and the rumbling of 500 hogs coming from Romford Market could not make a worse noise than this panting lane which does in my ears. Pray, see these soldiers their pay.
Ooh, we thank your worship.
Thanks, heroical captain.
No way.
We'll cut, bend, wind, your mistress and masters, wheresoever we come, follow brave Tearcat.
And pray, set war, let us go.
Wonder how thou camest to the knowledge of such villainous.
In my younger days, when I was apt to stray, I've sat among such adders, seen their stings as any here might, and in full playhouses watched their quick diving hands to bring to shame such rogues. And in that stream met an ill name. Good troth, my lord, I am made Maul Cutler so. Perhaps for my mad going, some reprove me. I please myself, and care not else who loves me.
My son marry a thief, impudent girl, the whole world sticks their worst eyes on. Now, sir, what news?
They were met upon the water an hour since, sir.
Delay no time, sweet gentlemen, to Blackfriars. We'll take a pair of oars and make after them.
Sir Alexander,
you are well met and most rightly served.
My daughter was a scorn to you.
Say not so, sir.
A very abject she, poor gentlewoman. Your house had been dishonored. Give you joy, sir, of your son's Gascon bride. You'll be a grandfather shortly to a fine crew of roaring sons and daughters. Who'll help to stock the suburbs passing well, sir.
Play not with the miseries of my heart. Wounds should be dressed and healed, not vexed and left wide open to the anguish of the patient, and scornful air let in. Rather let pity and advice charitably help refresh him.
Who would place his charity so unworthily, like one that gives alms to a cursing beggar? Had I but found one spark of goodness in you toward my deserving child, who then grew fond of your son's virtues, I had eased you now. But I perceive both fire of youth and goodness are raked up in the ashes of your age.
else no such shame had now come near your house, nor such ignoble sorrow touched your heart.
If not for worth, for pity's sake, assist me.
In vain you flatter him, Sir Alexander.
They are nearer than you think, Owen, yet more close than if they were further off.
Am I lost in these distractions?
For you all, I here engage my estate to half his wealth. Nay, to his son's revenues, which are less, and indeed nothing at all till they come from him. But I could, if my will stuck to my power, prevent this marriage yet. Nay, banish her forever from his thoughts, much more his arms.
Slack not this goodness, though you heap on me mountains of malice and revenge hereafter. I willingly resign up half my estate to him, so he would marry the meanest drudge I hire.
He talks impossibilities, and you believe him.
I talk no more than I know how to finish. My fortunes else are his that dare stake with me. The poor young gentleman I loved and pitied, and keep shame from him, because the spring of his affection was my daughter's first. Do but state him in those possessions which your love and care once pointed out for him, to give him entertainment to a noble birth, where now his desperate wants cast him upon her. But if I cannot, for his own sake chiefly, rid him of this foul disease that now grows upon him, I'll forfeit my whole estate before these gentlemen.
To the mash, gentlemen.
Ah, aye, sir, aye. I seek no favor, trust to you for none. My hope rests in the goodness of your son.
Life, here's Maul!
Jack!
How dost thou, Jack?
How dost thou, Gallant?
Impudence! Where's my son?
Weakness? Go look him.
Why, sir, take comfort now. There's no such matter. No priest will marry her, sir, for a woman while that shade's on. And 'tis never known two men were married and conjoined in one. Your son hath made some shift to love another.
Your son with his fair bride is near at hand.
Ah! Fair may their fortunes be! See where they come.
Before I dare discover my offense, I kneel for pardon.
My heart gave it thee ere thy tongue could ask it. Here are our friends. Salute her, gentlemen. Heart!
Who's this? Maul!
My reviving shame! Is it I must live to be struck blind? Be it the work of sorrow before age taken in hand?
Darkness and death, have you deceived me thus? Did I engage my whole estate for this?
Monstrous impudence!
You do not know the benefits I bring with me. No cheat dare work upon you with thumb or knife while you have a roaring girl to your son's wife.
Devil rampant! Have you so much charity to release me from my last rash bargain? And I'll give in your pledge.
No! I'll stand to it. I'll work upon advantages all mischief flew upon me.
Content! Bear witness all, then! His are the lands, and so contention ends. Here comes your son's bride, fixed two noble friends.
Now are you gold as you would be. Thank me for it. I'd a forefinger it.
Forgive me, father, though there before your eye my sorrow fame. This still was she for whom true love complained.
Your love's make my joys proud. Bring forth those deeds of land my care laid ready. Forgive me, worthy gentlewoman. 'Twas my blindness. When I rejected thee, I saw thee not. Sorrow and willful rashness grew like films over the eyes of judgment. Now so clear, I see the brightness of your words appear.
Duty and love may I deserve in those, and all my wishes have a perfect close.
That tongue sounds so sweet, could never err. Here, honest son, receive into your hands the keys of wealth, possession of those lands my first care prepared. They are thine own. You are a mad girl, but I cannot now condemn thee.
Condemn me? Truth, and you should, sir. I'd make you seek out one to hang in my room. I'd give you the slip of gallows and cousin the people. He was in fear his son would marry me, but he never dreamt that I would ne'er agree.
Why? Thou hast to suit her once, Jack. When wilt marry?
Then, my lord, I'll tell you in faith. When you shall hear gallants born of sergeant's fear, honesty and truth, unslandered, women man, but never pandered. If my mind be then not buried, next day following I'll be married. This sounds like doomsday. Your marriage best, for if I should repent, I were soon at rest.
Troth, thou art a good wench. I'm sorry now the opinion was so hard I conceived to be. Some wrongs I have done thee.
'Tis time for me to kneel and confess first. Upon my paws, I ask your pardon, dear mistress.
Pardon? For what? What has your rogueship done now?
I have been from time to time hired to confound you by this old gentleman.
To all which shame and grief in me cry, guilty. Forgive me. I'll never more condemn my common voice, for that's the whore that deceives man's opinion, mocks his trust, cozens his love, and makes his heart unjust. Worthy friends, my honorable lord, all your loves give luster to my joys. The happiness of this day shall be remembered at the return of every smiling spring. In my time now 'tis born, and may no sadness sit on the brows of men upon that day. But as I am, so all go, please, away.
A painter, having drawn with curious art the picture of a woman, every part lined with life, put out the piece to sell. People who passed along, viewing it well, gave several verdicts on it. Some dispraised the hair. Some said the brows too high were raised. Some hit o'er the lips, misliked the color. Some wished her nose were shorter, some the eyes fuller. Others said roses on her cheeks should grow, swearing they looked too pale. Others cried no. The workman still, as fault was found, did mend it in hope to please all. This work being ended and hung open at stall, it was so monstrous, so vile, and so ugly, all men did smile at the poor painter's folly. Such we doubt is this our comedy. Some perhaps do flout the plot, saying 'tis too thin, too weak, too mean. Some for the person will revile the scene, and wonder that a creature of her being should be the subject of a poet, seeing in the world's eye none weighs so light. Others look for those base tricks published in a book, foul as his brains they flowed from, of cut purse, of lips and voice, nasty, obscene discourses, as full of lies, as empty of worth or wit, for any honest ear or eye unfit. And thus, if we to every brain that's humorous should fashion scenes, we with the painter shall, in striving to please all, please none at all. And yet for such faults as either the writer's wit or negligence of the actors do commit, both crave your pardons. If what both have done cannot fulfill your expectation, the roaring girl herself some few days hence shall on this stage give larger recompense. Which mirth that you may share in herself does woo you, and craves this sign, your hands to beckon her to you.